Hello, good pin. Vanga etika Qataliña. I love me chiska Jackie Schaeffer. I am Jackie Schaeffer, and I am here with Ahtna Dine, Wilson Justin, who was raised in the traditional ways of his people. Wilson, I just want to ask you how the impacts of climate change that you've witnessed over your lifetime really impact not only your people, but the environment.
Good afternoon, and good question. It's actually pretty relevant for a lot of what you see as in terms of what we would call conflicts today or sociological fails. I can focus in on three aspects of this, what I've saw. And when you open up the discussion by saying raised in traditional ways, that will be part of the discussion, because the way I was raised in our traditional societies ended by the time between the age of 12 and 14 due to outside influences, particularly the school, the educational system, and the church-dominated theocracy that came into the village, but also to a lesser degree by the military prior to World War II, and also the question of what the modern job economy means, because that interrupted the economy I was raised in. So we have to backstep a second and say what I saw in terms of changes was threefold. First, it changed the way the villages and the participatory sharing economy that I was a part of by the time I was 12 or 14. 12 through 14. It became illegal to be a provider to the family. And that means fishing and trapping laws. So the first change in terms of climate change was directly related to the issue of imposition of values that are not consistent with the one that was there. How that relates to climate change is pretty straightforward. It took us away from direct connectivity 24/7. When I was 8, 9, 10 years of age, there was not a second or a time of the day when I was not aware of what was going on out there. Whether it was trapping, fishing, hunting, it didn't make any difference. All year long, even if it's 20 below, I would be out checking snares on the trail for supper. The imposition of the colonizing system took all of that and threw it out the door, basically. I said, you got to start over. And nobody wrote the book on what it means to go to jail or lose your license or those kind of things. They just simply said you got to start over. So climate change, in terms of my own background, was interrupted by the imposition of a system that had no meaning or bearing in terms of change or climate. And that brought forth a inconsistency in terms of village tribal life in my teen years, where the idea of self-reward and entitlement began to take a hold. In other words, we quit learning, we quit teaching, we quit absorbing, and we quit utilizing this sharing system that we had. All that happened by the time I started high school. So that brings us to the second phase of my outlook in terms of change on climate change, which is in high school, I began to learn that the issue of entitlement and self-gratification was secondary to the question of identity. In other words, you could not threaten, move, or in any way, shape, or form question the Euro-Western colony's identity. If you did, you were a no-good bum. And I learned this firsthand with bullies. They would mock me, laugh at me, make fun of me, curse me, swear at me, because of the way I talked, which was mangled English. I didn't have enough time to learn English before I got to high school. But not only the way I talked, but the way I looked, the way I walk, they would say things like, boy, you sure smell like a bear. Well, I didn't smell like a bear, but that was a point they needed to make in terms of their identity versus my identity. In other words, I would live hardly more than an animal in their world perspective and bullies. So in high school, I learned that this issue, what we would call ongoing change, ongoing activities in terms of learning, adjustments, what have you, was convoluted. It was turned upside down by the Euro-Western way of thinking in terms of identity. In other words, the only identity you're allowed to have is one that reflects who I am. I'm a white man, so you've got to be white, otherwise you're not part of it. That is something that I learned by the time I graduated from high school. So now let's take a look at the third component of the issue of worldview in terms of climate change. The first two are a complete indictment of the fact that the Euro-Western mindset rejected everything of natural values from the two-state era on, intentionally. So for basically almost 1,000 years now, the Euro-Western mindset has replaced any kind of a attitude towards this planet predicated upon natural forces as being wrong. That's the identity issue that I ran into, which means that climate change cannot happen unless it gets permission from the white man, which means that you can't have any kind of change on this planet or this universe unless you get permission from the white man. So by the time I was 22 years of age or 23 years of age, it was very clear to me. And we still haven't yet got to the idea that the third component, which is basically how did I get involved directly with the question of climate change? And for context, I needed to include those two earlier discussions because context-wise, I've always been involved in climate change. I just didn't know I was. So let's take a look at the question of my involvement with climate change. When I was about 8 or 9 years of age, I was listening to a couple of elders. They were talking about old stories. I was in the corner of the house, and they were talking about what we would call deep time. And deep time is creation-driven, or the sacred components of the development of the universe. And one of them, Houston Sanford, they're talking in Athabascan, and by then my Athabascan was already being jolted and tossed around and treated like some kind of a enemy by school system and churches. So I was beginning to lose the ability to stay connected. But here's the thing, these stories they were telling, the sacred stories, were in the original language of the medicine people, which were never taught to us kids. It was used in potlatches, referred to a chief talk, and it was used in sacred storytelling time in December. And this was in December. So Houston was talking to this other elder, and he said, you know, when you talk to kids, this is all in that language. And I'm trying to follow it. He said, when you talk to kids today, you make a big map for them over here, and they have another map over here, and the two maps are completely different. You can't use either one. He said, that's the way our kids are. They raised with this empty map. They call it English. And our regular map, the old people call it the sacred way, they can't connect. They're talking to each other about my inability to understand this. So flash forward about 10, 12 years, and I'm sitting around up there listening again to some of the elders talk about the question of changes. My Aunt Lena, who's still alive in Chistochina, Houston is gone for quite a few years. My Aunt Lena is in Chistochina, slowly losing her touch with the universe, but still very content person. We were out up on the side of the creek towards Nebesna, and she pointed down to the ground and she said, you see this thing, and it's a little round. She said, that's what the glacier caribou eat. Now, glacier caribou are now called part of the Metastar herd. There's another story, a whole separate story about how the Mentasta herd, now the Cheesh’na herd, which are woodland caribou, came into our region. We'll save that for a future day. But she said that's what those glacier ice caribou eat, those medicine people, caribou eat this stuff. Then we walked a little ways and she picked up a little tiny lichen. And she said that's what the regular caribou eat, and she didn't care. And she said they're both going. Something wrong here. Both these caribou feet are leaving us. I'm thinking to myself, what does that mean, leaving us? Well, fast forward again about 10, 12 years, and I'm beginning to assemble these things in my mind, and I'm beginning to look at the differences in what I'm hearing and what I'm putting together in English. They don't match. So some years later again, I'm talking with my uncle Carl Finion in the late 70s. He passed in 1980, and he said, you really got to go out and watch this stuff. He said, it's really changing. Things are really wrong. And I keep hearing that from the elders. Things are wrong. One of the things they said was, these leaves are all wrong. Well, wrong in English can't translate to wrong in Athabascan today. So I went out and I just started studying. I shouldn't use that term, it doesn't work here. What I did was I started watching these things in the springtime. By 1985, it was very clear to me that we had 2 weeks of extended growing season into springtime and another week in the fall of warm weather. So when they were saying the leaves are wrong, what they're saying is not that the leaves are wrong. They're saying that the green leaves are growing so much bigger, so much faster. That term wrong comes into context by saying, when you look at the question that the foliage is outgrowing the ability to stay fed and connected to the water table. Once that became clear to me, I began looking at how the growth foliage is impacted by something called permafrost. So I went out, looked at the permafrost, I was flabbergasted to find out that it had disappeared. And I said, holy cow, where you been all your life, fella? you're almost 35 years old and you just found out these things are changing in a way that is explainable. So I began looking at the question of life cycles of permafrost, and that's a whole different field. But the point of my discussion here is I went through this process of not only being denied my own learning growth cycles, but being told that it was dirty and no good and wrong. And then finally I get to the point where I can stop listening to that kind of garbage and junk and began looking at the question of how do I connect back to what is being told to me, which brings me directly into the issue of language conflicts. Once you get past the idea of language conflicts, once you look at the question of all languages have a purpose, English has a purpose. Just the purpose is very very small and very convoluted in terms of entitlement and protection of your rights. You can't have protection of individual rights in the indigenous world because that is a universal theme. You protect the universe first, because the universe then repays the protection with the gift of protection of your life. In the Indian world, as the Yupik and every place else, the idea of a language utilized as a tool to protect yourself is impossible. It doesn't exist, cannot exist. So we have this issue of language. I had to come to grips with English, not being hostile, but not being useful. That's a very tough step to take. When a bully comes up to you, spits in your face, you punch him back, his friends come along and they beat you up, and you chase them down one at a time to beat them up. That's the way it is with language. You're not supposed to reply hostile force with hostile force. It's okay to protect yourself, but you don't go beat up all of a guy's friends. We're doing that with the way we are, our indigenous identity is being process. So we're looking at violence begets violence. Force means more force. So the language issue today is pretty basic. We need to get away from the fact that the language that is a part of our life forces us into conflict. We need to say stop. Climate change is unsolvable until we stop doing what we do in terms of these conflicts, overlaps of what we would call hostilities. I'm not doing the hippie thing where I say you gotta love everybody. I'm saying you gotta love the universe more than you love yourself. And the universe is all about your future grandchildren. So basically climate change in my life came in those three eras. First is the very very basic, take away all of the attributes and values of our society to turn me into something ready for change. Then bring the change in terms of making you mean, wild, hostile. Then it's easy for you to become addicted to yourself. I rejected all of those and went to the other side of the coin, which is when the elders were teaching me something, what they taught me was that to be more what I would refer to a part of what is out there rather than what I want. That was the basic lesson, because climate change in today's vernacular no longer is climate change, it's a done deal. The train wreck already happened. We're just going to have to figure out how we're going to speak to each other in terms of not only rebuilding, but what it is we're going to rebuild. We don't want more scientists, we don't want more universities, we don't want more industrialization, more capitalism, we want more values. So values is the key. When we say values will run everything in our life, everything else automatically comes into being in terms of benefit as opposed to what we would call impact or hostility. So that's my short version of a 3-year degree in climate change.
Well, Kuyanakpak, and the words of wisdom for health and wellness of all people, right?
Yep.
Yep.
Everybody.
Yeah, thank you.